talk show, which is CANDID AT CICERONI Live. More often than not, fashion is really chuckled over as a topic. It's considered to be pretty superficial, flippant, frivolous. Maybe I don't really care about fashion. These are the kind of statements you will hear when one talks about fashion. But scratch the surface a little deeper more, and you will realize that fashion is beyond just the flippantness. You might want to associate with the culture, the society that it kind of reflects about. It is one of the biggest employment generating industry for women. It is the second biggest polluter globally after oil. So after hearing this, probably you might want to really know what happens in the fashion industry, wouldn't you? So to discuss such topic about fashion indicator as a societal change, we have with us Pramila Chaudhary. Hi Pramila, welcome to the show. So let me kind of begin with a little bit of introduction about Pramila, and I'm going to keep it short because she really categorically mentioned to keep it short. Pramila is a sustainable textile and fashion designer. She's an artist, researcher and design educator trained in India and Switzerland, especially in NID and HSLU. She has about more than 10 years of work experience. She's recently done her public art project at Kunehar Art Festival and a millet mold project at Abhivyakti 2. These are the two prime examples of her creating conversations through fashion as a medium and using art into it and generate dialogues at the intersection of fashion, art and culture. She also works on a project called Project Hand Stitch, which is an open platform to promote slow living and sustainable fashion by re-emphasizing people to use the old intergenerational forgotten techniques like hand stitching, rafugari, natural dyes, and so on through workshops and online medium. So I think that's too long an introduction already, Pramila. So let's begin with the first question, you know. What is the impact of culture on fashion? Like a big question.
That's a really, really big question in the beginning itself.
Yes.
Culture, you can't ignore culture and fashion altogether. Whenever you see, right now we are putting fashion as a bracket and this is trendy and this is not. But if you see your older generation, how they were dressing up, and recently when I was in Gunair, my main work was around having this, to find out these intergenerational transition between fashion and culture. And there were these five generations right now.
Sure.
And I would say the people who were more than 60 years old, I was meeting like people who are 101 years old,
oh,
or 90 years old, 80 years old. They are like more, wearing what their culture is all about and the clothing is all about, and they are very bold and fearless about it. And each detail of the garment, it's not like today is a casual wear and tomorrow is a formal wear, and the kind of terms,
notions that we have in fashion.
Yeah, and there is nothing like that. They work in the same clothing on the fields, in the same clothing they are cooking food, they are meeting people and attending some function in the evening. It's a one attire altogether. And at the same time, the new ones were there and they have these so-called, tongue watches. But this is, I guess, we imposed with so much of information floating around on social media, on print media or anywhere, even movies for that matter, they influence a lot.
Right.
Okay. And so I think so culture does impact, or I think so culture is the one which we... as a community, we bring culture to our clothing. So earlier it was like one particular community wearing certain kind of colors, certain kind of motifs. So there was this hidden visual language. You never say that the so-called caste is, when we keep talking about. So people never label that you are this or you are that. But this was very subtly told to people that this is how it is. The colors.
An example that you can give.
So, for example, in Kutch or other areas, people wear certain blocks. So, how you define a girl is married or unmarried? Simple thing like that.
Yeah.
So, they have these tucks in their blouses.
Huh.
So, one who are married, they have these certain number of tucks, and the unmarried one doesn't have. Similarly, in Rajasthan, if I say they have these, if a baby is born, they have something called pila, which is a yellow bandhani. And they have red color, small like laddus on it, so it's a sweet. So the circles they have been made. So these are like indication that in that gathering, the one lady who's having that particular odhna or something covering herself, she's the one we are celebrating. And
how interesting.
So we don't saying that, oh, like, you know, it's not confusing that everybody is wearing same clothes and you have to now find out that, you know, who's the mother.
Who's the mother, who's like the star attraction.
So these were that's kind of a wisdom, I would say, our generation could have bring to our system, where there's nothing written. It's all oral, all visual, all colors, all patterns. So how you identify and talk about it.
So how you also worked with, I think, Avni Kumar.
Yeah.
How was your experience there, or the Swiss company that you worked with, you know, their cultural implication, if any?
Avni was more about, Avni is a very interesting NGO working in Uttarakhand, and they kind of revived many things over there which is kind of lost. So they started weaving, and so the weavers they have, they're not trained weavers. So they don't know what to weave, and they really, and if you go and ask these people ever that, oh, what is your cultural clothing is all about, or you ask questions like these, they will never
give
you answers, because they never see their dressing like that
in that perspective.
We as outsider looking at it in that way,
right?
And with the Swiss thing, it was more like, you know, my work was to introduce Indian crafts over there, and also to understand what is there in the surroundings. So we were working and traveling to really, really remote areas of Switzerland to find out if even a single person who is working by hand right now, because and then we were visiting a lot of these museums and many, many places, but trust me, there was not even a single person who's still working with hands.
Actually, they don't.
No, so they all migrated to like high technology and smart fashion, or smart textiles, I would say, which has like little more functional or aesthetic. It's beyond aesthetic. It's more like a functional
technical garments.
Or it's all digital printing or a very, very quick fast fashion thing.
Sure.
So there is a drastic, so in one, so both the ways we were trying to figure out something is lost, and we are trying to trace back. But in Avni is a very beautiful example how they bring back that old tradition
by training other people.
Training in a way where they're using the same material, they restarted natural dye, many things, but training in a way the product are more contemporary, which is you and me can wear it right now,
right,
or use it.
Right.
Maybe anybody, a man, a woman, anyone, but their traditional clothing, if they start remaking, I don't think so they could spread that much.
Sure.
Because there will be very limited people who are going to buy just to appreciate that area or the craft,
right,
or something like that.
Right, right, right. So training extra will make sense.
Yeah.
So, how do you see the cultural influence on the buying pattern? Like, purchase decisions are always made depending on the demographics and the geography.
Yeah.
Since you worked earlier with a knitwear company, and probably Arvind also, and right now you are consulting a Panipat-based company, Swiss company, with a lot of experience around, how do you think that experience translates to buying?
So in terms of
purchasing decisions, how are they made?
The people who are in the surrounding you're
correct
talking about?
Yes.
Or anyone?
Anyone who decides to purchase. So if Arvind today decides to purchase something in Ahmedabad,
right,
she has a lot of consideration of cultural demographics around her, you know. Where does she stay in Ahmedabad, you know, the local mode of transportation, and around that the purchasing decision happens.
Yeah.
If somebody stays in the US,
and
probably a place like New York, the decision would be different. You
right
know?
Right.
So since the places that you travel, how did you notice the difference in the purchasing?
That visuals are quite evident. And like if I say Panipat, people, again, it's a very small city, and people do buy, because lot of things come there from all over the world to recycle, and they have these small little markets where people sell these new second-hand garments. So
okay,
that is one, because somebody is feeding you, it's there in terms of abundant, you know, space, so you kind of get attracted and buy that. But still they have these small little lanes, but there I can't find anything which is a craft or something I really want to buy, a local thing. it's not available. I mean, I couldn't find it till now.
Correct. So craft we do not get. But
yeah. But their influence more is from other countries, which is sending all their secondhand clothes to this small hub where they recycle these clothes.
So actually they are sent for recycling, but they are still sold outside.
So what happened, when these business model develop, you know, so there are these underlying things where people take out certain things which are new, nicer, or they segregate in certain way. But if their requirement is done, still there is more what to do with that more. So they will sell it to, or sometimes they give it free. Simple example, so we visited one of the factory who do, it's a very renowned brand and compliance for that fact. That factory was compliant for that, and we wanted to know if we can use that material because recycling you're doing, you know. They have heaps of fabrics and garments which is like yellows, and people are just segregating and everything. So I was wondering what happened to the trims, because the buttons and zippers, because if you have so many fabric, they are also in good numbers. And that this is of no use to me. There's like room full of buttons, you know. I just give it to these street hawkers and they will burn it as a fuel. So casually they're saying, and the one who's doing recycling, they don't understand what they're doing and what is happening with this recycling, because again you're consuming the electricity and spoiling the water, and inside all fibers are there. People can't breathe. The people who are working there, they don't have masks or anything.
Sure.
Things like that.
Sure.
You know?
Sure.
And at the same time, if you talk about Switzerland, people are very, very conscious what they're buying, how they're buying, what their buying patterns are. So the kind of people I was working with or having a group, so all age group were there, and they were very conscious what they're eating, what they're wearing, and how much they're not frequently buying. They were conscious on, and they have these little markets, which is like a Tuesday market or Saturday market. They're beautiful market where people buy secondhand goods, at the same time food which is coming from local farmers. So these markets are interesting. You can go and you can find these vintage clothes and vintage accessories or something which is quite interesting. So that influences a lot, because that is happening on weekly basis. So the child is also seeing, and the older ones also, and they go specifically to buy things from these markets because you can't find it anywhere else.
Yes, yes.
Interesting.
So what was your idea behind the minute moment art installation that you did at Abhivyakti?
Yes.
Abhivyakti 2 was the art and the cultural event that happened in Ahmedabad about 2 months ago.
Yes,
two
it
months
was in
ago.
April.
Yes, yes. So what was that?
That was my reflection on. So once I was part of the circle where I was producing a lot of garment mass production. For like 5-6 years I've done that, and unconsciously I was seeing, while making on the floor, when you see lakhs of t-shirts have been made, so there is a cutting happening,
right.
And that waste is generating. So that time maybe I was not that conscious, or never pay attention what is happening next, because there used to a vendor used to come and he used to take that waste, but what happened next may have no idea. So that was one, to use textile as a medium and waste specifically. And as I mentioned, that you mentioned a long list of places I work or I have been working, so I travel a lot because of work, and in between these waiting periods are there, right, at airport or railway station or anywhere.
Right.
So we are not comfortable with humans anymore. That is what my observation was after like traveling a little longer. And I like, can we do something where if we put people in a defined area, what happened, how they are going to react? That was the starting point. Medium and everything came later. Because even how you're comfortable with yourself, if I take your phone from you, are you able to, you know, stay just for an hour doing nothing?
I do.
I'll be so happy. No, because even resting something we forgot. We are constantly like, we are missing on something, or somebody is feeding.
Yeah.
It's good. It's a very good tool, and you can reach to many places, know many things. So many.
Yeah, we are doing that.
We are doing
that right
now.
Yeah,
I understand.
Yeah.
But overwhelming. It's overpowering your life. Right now. So that was the idea, and then I also wanted to make the structure little overwhelming as well. They are like 12 feet, 10 feet, 8 feet. So you are in such a confined area. And first thing, we were sure that people will come and take a selfie.
Yeah.
Because it's very beautiful and nice and everything. But slowly, slowly when they step inside. So there were one area where 10 people can sit. So as I was mentioning, slowly, slowly there are these conversations are happening. Somebody is talking about some particular thing and you like it, you start coming and joining us as well. So these things were happening, and there was one which was for the single person. Most of the people couldn't stay inside. They just come, it was just on your face. So you just come out because you feel claustrophobic. And some of them were like half an hour not even coming out. So different reflections were happening. And there was an interesting point on the very first day. So there was Ankita, one of my interns, was working with me. And I came home and I come in sometime, opening was happening. And we also put two dustbins over there. They were like industrial dustbin. One was where we had these takeaway smaller ones. So you kind of unknowingly taking out something from the dustbin, you know.
Huh.
And one was where you're writing the feedback.
Hmm.
So a few people came before opening and they're like, this is such a huge, nice, beautiful structure. Why are you putting dustbin here? And they really removed it. And me and the curator Mithul, we were laughing at it that this is actually working. This is what we wanted, because if I tell you this is all about this, then you might have, you not react the way you wanted to react. So that was happening. And locals, elderly people and even the young ones. So we also had the soundscape inside. So somewhere it was like, you know, very techno music, which make you uncomfortable. But that was making people more comfortable. And the one I was saying, for the single person, we had like music for the soundscape was like water or soothing, you know.
Right,
so
right.
Some people were really liking, but some of them were really cut. Because there was a pin drop silent, and it's kind of made, it was so heavy, so it made this acoustic wall around you. You really can't see or hear anything from outside.
Sure.
It was scary for people. So yeah, that was about
minute more.
Yeah,
that was an interesting concept. Can you break down for the viewers, like the layman who would kind of want to understand the semantic difference between clothes, fashion and style? Because we confuse all the three words.
Right.
You know? And that's where the flippancy of fashion comes into picture.
See, clothes, first of all, why these are the basics, no? Like roti kakam.
Correct.
So we need these basics, right? But how much you need and how many requirement you have even throughout the day. I was saying that casual wear or a formal wear or a wedding or occasional, or we just started putting so many labels and names to confuse people. I have one trouser, I could wear the same for my formal and even denim for that matter, right? It's such a versatile garment, you can wear anywhere and how you style it.
Yeah.
You know, either you're wearing a white shirt on it or something which is very floral or loose or casual, or a kurta for that matter. That changes how
right.
it looks, you know.
Right.
But we just put a lot of labels and make people buy that you have a casual wear and now you are joining the office or having certain meetings, certain specific occasion, you need to buy that as well. Then we have a bridal wear coming in the picture. I don't know the likes of money people are spending on that bridal wear. And earlier it was like more like a heirloom where you get somebody from your grandmother or your mother in really nicely crafted garments, which were either, you know, saris, which is passed on to the generation, or you made something. So I remember in Rajasthan, we have certain communities, they really used to have the gold and silver wire work on the garment. So the idea was, so they can really sell later, take off. So that is something you don't need to put everything in your lockers.
Right.
So this is somehow your treasure.
Right.
Something similar, right now you see a lot of nomads.
Which is clothes and culture. Right?
Yes.
That is clothes.
Clothes.
Fashion is, which is fed to you through probably magazines, advertise,
yes.
style, trend
movies.
Forecast, movies, fashion forecast, Pantone colors, must buy.
So these, again, trend, Pantone, we are like, now Pinterest is so easily available. People just find it and it's like a maddening space where you keep going inside,
right?
Even these blogs which influence you. But as simple as the simple people who are like a layman who are watching these so-called your serials, you know, and they get influenced by that, and you will see those patterns repeating in the market like anything. Komolika ka ghagra. I mean, what is it? I mean, why you are making this thing?
Right. So that is a trend.
Yeah. So trend, somebody is setting, and so also I guess there are these link up between who's selling and who's marketing. You will also find the certain kind of sari named after something, or Apple logo, you know, on a sari.
Correct.
So in villages you find such motifs a lot,
yeah.
And people are unknowingly wearing it because this is how it is.
So before I move on to the other question that I've got, I have two more quick questions. One is, what is your take on political dressing in current times? Like, this is my favorite topic. And can fashion make political statements, considering what has happened, like we spoke about it?
Of course, it is making. If you start from people name after, you know, the Nehru jacket or a Modi jacket now, for that matter. Or Indira Gandhi was one of the iconic person who has, you know, kind of celebrated handloom industry and the saris, the way she used to dress up. You need not to be in trousers if you want to be, you know,
making a statement.
You need not to wear any other Western or Indian, however you are comfortable, but she made sari comfortable among the elite group of people and the youngster at that time, you know, who were doing something which is out of the league, which people not, because design 10 years or 60 years ago or 50 years ago was not a common thing for people to do it. And if designers were there and how they dress up. So most of the people that time, they got influenced by, because somebody is leading, you know, a leader, and you always look up to that person, whether an intellectual or a layman, because everybody is looking at them some or other.
Sure.
And even the colors, how we are protesting with certain color in certain parliamentary spaces, you know, the black I'm wearing and I'm protesting. So I'm silently making a statement over there.
Sure.
And it's kind of really, and certain people in our political scenario right now, you can see the persona it is. These white crisp kurtas and, you know, colorful. Agar neta hai, koi hum MP hai, so you have to wear that attire. That is in their mind. And that's how they portrayed. Somebody can, the youngsters are wearing like even trousers and shirts and going. They are not, but the generation before them, they have this fixed idea of what is a political program.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So it definitely makes an impact on the culture. Like,
we
start identifying people through the clothes they wear.
Yes.
Those through globalization that might have decreased, but I think it is still coming back now.
It is.
You see the resurgence of it.
Yes. Also, if you see the people, the other politicians who are coming from different countries, or they are meeting, you can see this is from India, this is from Bhutan, this is from US. By how they dress up, you know, just because of that, you can see people very distinctly. They are from a different places, but they are together for some reason. And that influenced a lot of people. Still a layman to kid to intellectuals, to everyone.
Sure, yeah, sure. And so going back to this one thing, that wonderful thing that you are wearing right now, what was this whole meter clothing idea? We have seen a lot of your posts on 4 meter fabric and the drape and all of it. So what's that?
Yeah, I was also like the fast fashion in person once upon a time. And when I was in Switzerland, I was there was a space, they segregated the waste in different way. They were beautiful, like clean, nice space and nice boxes over there, and everybody go in other ways. Apart from, there was one big thing was textile. And like, how textile can be a waste? And when you travel with everything what you have in your life.
Right.
I would say, and I did the same, and I kind of, it was a daily, you know, visual in my life those days. So after coming back, I kind of dumped everything in that, and I was like, let me come back and declutter my
myself.
So I did that, and it took me a little longer than usual because I was keeping things from even my 10th standard, can you imagine? I mean, it's so nice, I can't do anything. Every year I take it out and keep it back. I had clothes which is I could wear, if I don't repeat it, I can wear it for 3 years at a stretch, and I did that, and now I feel really like what I was doing. But I think so that was required somewhere to make me understand. It is a very personal thing right now, and
then we used to have these so-called garba in NIT, right? And they wear chaniya and everything. And I like, I can't buy chaniya just for a one night garba, right? Or 9 days. So, or how much you borrow also.
Yeah.
Because everybody needs it. So that's how I started braiding sarees. In a way that it doesn't look saree. It looked some kind of a chaniya or some kind of a pant or dhoti or something.
Yeah.
That's how it started. And then I really liked the idea of, and also, I come from Rajasthan. I see men specifically in draped clothes a lot.
Right.
This is like a visual from my childhood since now. And this is interesting, and now I understand why they have more clothes, like, I mean, fabrics which is like 4 meter, 5 meter, 6 meter fabric. They're just draping comfortably. So, and in India, if you see everything, I call it meter clothing because if I go and buy something from the market, I don't say I want a gamcha which is 1.5 meter long or a one. I just say gamcha, I just say sari, I just say lungi or dhoti. We have this predefined idea that dhoti will be this meter, you know. So somewhere we, our culture is such that we have, and beautifully we had this draped clothing culture, and now for so many years I'm doing
so
it.
So post-traditional cycling came in where the pants
stitch,
and the trousers,
specifically
stitch.
The blouse,
started
from that. Yeah, yeah. Other influences as well, like Mughals came and they gave you these anarkali kind of things. And because the drape clothing was something which we inherit from our ancestors.
Yeah.
And it was the most zero waste clothing one can have ever in their life.
Absolutely. The drape.
However you want. This
yeah.
is sari right now I'm wearing, and I wear it as a sari, as a skirt, as a blouse, as a whatever I like to. And it's really hot right now. It's a very nice fabric which is 6 meter, but so what, it's malmal and I can enjoy wearing it.
Which is fantastic.
Yeah. So that's how it is, and I keep experimenting a lot. And I like more people to learn so that they can incorporate in their life, rather than as a textile designer we keep buying
fabrics, textiles.
So, and there were fabrics, my 4 meter is so evident because I used to buy these 4 meter fabrics, and they're so nice, hand-loom and whatnot. I didn't want to cut it. Every time I take it out, no, this is so nice, let's keep. And the things I had like past 5 years, 4 years, I started now taking out and draping them.
Right.
So I'm feeling so good about it that every time I drape and there's a new garment coming out.
It's also a way of practicing sustainable fashion.
Yes,
like
yes.
You can just use one garment into multiple ways.
Yes.
And not kind of really worry about getting tired of the same style.
Even this whole confusion what to wear.
Yes,
whenever you go anywhere and you save a lot of time when it is clear in your mind, right? And now it's so easy, I can quickly drape it, like, because I am doing possibly
so long. So let's take to the last question. It is, how important is transparency of manufacturing process to bring about a social change? It's a big question.
No, you see things like fashion revolution is something on similar lines they are doing.
Right. Right.
Or they are trying to even connect communities all over the world how it is. And if there is a transparency, you know your buying is having some impact and from where it is coming. The people are more conscious right now because sustainability is a buzzword right now. It's a trend. You know, we just put it everywhere, but the trend, what does it mean, and how my buying from a mall impact, if in a mall there is a small brand and which that brand is giving me enough transparency in terms of raw material, the people are making, the makers involved, the processes, the dyeing process, because nobody is talking about it. And the water crisis, what we are talking about right now, it's all about, if you go to Narol, there is even in Panipat, there are certain areas where dyeing is happening, you can't stand, you can't breathe.
Right.
It's so dirty. One is, there is some black layer in the environment. Right now we have a lot of light here in Andhra, but there I can't see. And we really go to remote like lanes and see what is happening there, because we need to work as well and to understand what is happening. And it's stinking. People are like barefoot working there. And after a point, they have some physical problem. These are like a hidden lines which we don't see as a consumer.
So underbelly of fashion industry.
Yes, it is. It is, and it is very badly spread right now. But there is a big movement happening all over the world where, like, not only in India, people are promoting studio the small scale businesses, whether it is a designer or an artisan or traditionally somebody is making a small kind of
local
darzi for that. Customization of your garment, because we used to do a lot.
Right.
Now people are going back to those practices, and if we all start doing that slowly, I think so it's enough change which we can bring, needed change.
It has been really insightful talking to you, Pramila, and understanding that how fashion can bring about, one can go back and trace back actually your culture globally through different countries through following the fashion actually. Century-wise, we keep kind of seeing it has changed and it has transitioned and it is transitioning right now. So thank you so very much for
thank
the
so
time.
Much for the life.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much everyone for watching this, and if you really like what we kind of talked about right now, do share, like, subscribe and comment on it. We will be live back again next week, Wednesday, 2:30 p.m. with another fashion personality in Ahmedabad. See you.